Book of John, chapter 19, says, "Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe. And they said, 'Hail, King of the Jews.' And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, 'Behold, I bring him forth to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him.' Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate saith unto them, 'Behold the man.'"
But the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering,
Well, good Palm Sunday morning, everyone. We hope that you are doing well, and we do pray that if any of you are having any problems or difficulties, please feel free to contact us, anyone on the board, the pastor, and give a ring to us, and we'll try to help meet any needs that you might have. During this time of staying at home, rather than binge watch too much things on YouTube and otherwise, we would ask that you turn to the church website, find the links on to YouTube to get the videos that we're producing here. There's getting to be a good library of them now. The men's and women's Bible studies will be available probably in the next day or so for the week ahead, so look for those. Also, continue to send your offerings in if you would. Send that to Bible Fellowship Church, attention to the church treasurer, Post Office Box 560, Arlington, Ohio, 45814. This time, shall we bow our heads in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we do again thank you for the power that you are, Lord, that you are in charge of the entire creation. It's your creation, Lord, everything about it you created. Lord, we just pray that we will never forget that. Lord, I thank you that you were willing to lay down your life on the cross for us, that you were first willing to come and live the life of a man. You laid that down on the cross, and Lord, that you on the third day arose again to conquer death and sin forever for us. Lord, I just pray that throughout the week we will have opportunity to share with others and that we will boldly share with others your gospel, Lord, their way of salvation, And Lord, we just pray that at this time when people are seeking you, we will be diligently at work to get your word out. Lord, I pray for everyone in our church family. We pray for health for everyone, Lord. We pray that emotionally they'll be able to stay strong through all of this. And Lord, we just pray that you will be with the leadership of our nation, our state, our local leaders as well, Lord. We just pray that you will give them wisdom to make the right decisions without taking our freedoms away. And Lord, we just pray that you'll be with all the healthcare people, Lord, that continue to risk their lives daily. And we just pray that you'll protect them. Lord, we think of our missionaries scattered around the globe, and Lord, we just pray that you'll continue to bless their ministries, be with them at this time that's going on throughout the world, that you'll keep them healthy, Lord, and keep them safe. We think at this time of Dale and Jody Davis, who have finished their work in Bangladesh, and they're back in the United States, and Lord, we just pray that you'll keep them healthy and help them as they're planning on their next ministry, Lord. Lord, we think of those who are suffering at this time. We just think of Craig Woodard and his family with the passing of his brother. We just pray that you'll be with them. Lord, we think of those with health problems. We think of Doug Drupp and Betty Bibler at this time, and we just pray that you'll keep them safe, and others that are fighting health problems that might make them even more susceptible to the current virus, and we just pray that you'll give them extra protection, Lord. We think of the new baby that the Probst have had, and we just pray that you'll continue to strengthen that child, Lord. And Lord, all the others who have health problems, we just pray that you'll be with them. Lord, we just pray that you'll continue to bless this ministry, and we just pray that we'll be a beacon to the community. And we just pray, Lord, for your continued blessing throughout the week ahead. In thy name we ask it. Amen.
These pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed but not forsaken, I've been set free, I've been set free. Set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel. The world to see your life in me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I can see you now. can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember Redemption's hill, where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I want, you were as I tempted and tried. You led. The Word became flesh, bore my sin and death. Now you're risen, and everything I once held dear, count it all as lost. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. In the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flames. Now the gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Thank you very much. That was so beautiful. William Parker was a 45-year-old businessman, and a good one at that. But he was very active in his local church. He loved teaching Sunday school to the children. He also enjoyed writing hymns. One day he walked into a Sunday school class, and all the kids said, "Mr. Parker, Mr. Parker, tell us another story." And he was so moved by that, he went home and he wrote, "Tell me the story of Jesus, and write on my heart every word. Tell me that story that's most precious, the sweetest that's ever been heard. tell how they nailed him onto that cross, and tell about the grave where they laid him, but tell how he liveth again. Love in that story is so tender, clearer than ever I've seen. Stay, let me weep while you whisper. It was love that paid the ransom for me. I'd like to tell you the story of Jesus this morning. I'd like to take you back to Calvary and see what Jesus, our blessed Lord and Savior, did on our behalf. I'd like to approach it from John's Gospel. John's Gospel is unique. It's not like Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John wrote from an eternal perspective. John writes like a highly skilled prosecuting attorney. He wants to lay before you in his gospel the incredible evidence that's indisputable that Jesus Christ is indeed who he claims to be. And he wants every member of the jury at the end of this trial to raise their hand and admit that he is indeed the Son of God. In his gospel, which has 21 chapters, you can divide the book equally into two parts. The first part, chapters 1 through 11, you have incredible evidence that Jesus is the Messiah. He affirms his ministry in those 11 chapters. For example, in chapter 2 of John's gospel, he instantaneously turned several gallons of normal water into something that was extraordinary. He turned it into wine. And he did it without the process of fermentation. He did it instantly. And what Jesus Christ did with that water in John chapter 2, he can do in your life. In John chapter 5, he went to the local hospital in town, went back to the worst of all patients and stood over him, asked that man a question who had been lying in that condition, paralyzed for 38 years. Would you like to be made whole? That man began to offer up all kinds of excuses. And Jesus cut to the quick. He said, "Arise, take up your bed, and walk." And immediately, after 38 years, this man rolled up his pallet, put it on his shoulder, and walked out of the place. I say to you once again that what Jesus did with that man, he can do in your individual life. You're making all kinds of excuses as to why you're not following Jesus Christ today. Now, that man had all of his excuses dealt with. He began to follow Jesus. You turn a few pages later in chapter 9, you discover there was a man who was born blind. Never saw that beautiful, bright moon last night. Never saw the beautiful sunrise this morning. Never saw the birds flying through the air. But Jesus put clay on that man's eyes, asked him to go south to the pool of Siloam and just dip there. And he went there and he washed, and the Bible says he came back seeing. I tell you this morning that what Jesus did in that man's life, spiritually speaking, he can do in yours. If you're blind and can't see, the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, you simply trust him and obey him, he'll give you spiritual sight. And yet, if you're not convinced after all that hard evidence, Jesus comes down on top of it with the greatest miracle of all. It's right in the center of John's gospel. He takes you over to his friend Lazarus's grave. He's been there now for 4 days, and he merely speaks the word. He says, "Lazarus, come forth." And he who was dead came back to life again. I tell you, if you will not follow Jesus Christ, it's because the evidence is not there. It's because you choose not to follow him. You choose not to trust him. You choose not to obey him. He affirmed his ministry like none other in those 11 chapters. But I want you to walk with me now down that Via Della Rosa this morning. I want us to go to Calvary. And I want to show you from God's word that not only did he affirm his ministry, but he accomplished what he came into this earth to do. He accomplished his mission. John chapter 13, if you have your Bibles, you might want to follow along. Actually, chapter 12, let's start there. Jesus is holding a feast at the home of Lazarus, of all things. He just raised him from the dead in chapter 11. And there's Martha who's serving, and there's Mary who's anointing the feet of Jesus. And from that setting, Jesus is about to ride into the city of Jerusalem on a donkey to fulfill Old Testament prophecy in the book of Zechariah 500 years before. Zechariah said, you'll know it's the King of all kings. You'll know it's the Lord of all lords. This is how you'll know it. He is just bringing salvation, and he's lowly riding on a donkey. Can't miss it if you've got eyes to see it. Jesus told a couple of his followers to go into a village and untie a colt. If they ask you, why are you doing that? Just simply tell them, the Lord hath need of him. Those disciples obeyed Jesus. They went over to a village. They began to untie the colt. And sure enough, the owner says, what are you doing untying the colt? They looked at him and said, the Lord has need of him. Well, if the Lord has need of him, help yourself. He was very popular. He had healed a lot of people. I want you to imagine just for a moment, life from that donkey's perspective. After all, Jesus could have come riding into town on an Arabian stallion, but he chose to ride the colt, the foal of a donkey. That colt would have said, why did he choose me? And the simple answer is because the Lord hath need of him. You might be sitting there at home. You might be wondering, does the Lord have need of me? Absolutely. He has need of your time, he has need of your talent, he has need of your treasure. The Lord chose, of all things, a little colt. They began to throw branches in the way, palm branches, and they began to hail him as King of all kings, Lord of all lords. In fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy, Jesus came into town on a borrowed donkey. And Jesus, in John chapter 12, verse 24, began to teach the people. Interesting to me that John kind of condenses this part of the week, narrows it down to a couple of verses. In verse 24, it says, this is Jesus teaching the people in this final week on earth, that except a corn of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it abides alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. Verse 25 says, if you love your life, you'll lose it. But if you'll hate your life, for my sake and the gospel, you'll discover at the end of the day that you have eternal life. So Jesus, my dear blessed Lord and Savior, came into Jerusalem, riding on a donkey, and he began to teach the people that week. And then John seems to fast forward to Thursday, where the disciples were set in an upper room. And Jesus got up from where he was sitting. The disciples should have done this. It was just common courtesy, like asking someone when they walk into a room, may I take your coat? May I give you a drink of water? Jesus got up from where he was sitting. He took off his outer garment. He girded himself with a towel and he began to kneel down, and one by one by one by one, he began to wash the disciples' feet. Came to Peter, and Peter began to say, Lord, you're never going to wash my feet. And Jesus says something very insightful. He says, Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. Well, in that case, Lord, wash all of me. And Jesus said, Peter, you don't need a bath. You're already converted. You've had the bath when you trusted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. But as you walk the side streets of Jerusalem, maybe even down the main street, and by the way, when you walk the side streets of Hancock County and the main streets of Hancock County, your feet will get dusty. See, that's what communion really is all about. Jesus was transforming 1,500 years of observing Passover. He was transforming into what we do on a typical first Sunday of every month. He was transforming it into communion. And by the way, since we're not able to gather like this as a church, let me just encourage you at home that you can do in your living room what we do here the first Sunday of every week. The twofold purpose of communion is so that you can stop long enough to examine your heart. Maybe there are things I've touched this week. Now my hands are dirty. Maybe my eyes have seen things that they shouldn't have seen, and my eyes are now dirty. Maybe my ears have heard things that are filthy, and now I can't have that communion with the Lord. No, part of communion in the local church is that we might examine ourselves and come clean before God and ask Him to cleanse our hearts from sin so we can have pure fellowship with Him. The second purpose of communion is so that we might remember what Jesus did for us in the past, what He's currently doing for us in the present, and what He will do when He gathers all the redeemed of all the ages one day, and He's going to sit down, and we're going to have fellowship with Him forevermore. So they're upstairs in the room. Jesus is washing their feet. And when He finishes, the Bible says in John chapter 13, He begins to grow very sorrowful. And He says to His followers, "One of you is going to betray me." Of course, they all snapped back and wondered who it was. Peter, at the head of the table, must have motioned to John and said, "Ask him, which one is it?" And Jesus said, "This piece of bread that I'm holding, I'm going to dip it into this sop. And I'm going to give it to the person who's going to betray me." So He dipped that piece of bread and He gave it to Judas Iscariot. And Jesus looked at Judas Iscariot and He said, "What thou doest, do quickly." And the Bible says in John's gospel that He went out and it was night. Always dark when you turn your back on Jesus Christ. When you disobey His pleading, His voice, His calling out to you. And so Judas went to see the religious officials to betray Jesus Christ for 30 pieces of silver. Well, if I'm reading John's gospel correctly, the meal is over. They sing a hymn and they go out. But Jesus says to His followers, His disciples who are still there, "This night, all of you shall offend me." Once again, Peter bolstered up and said, "I would never offend you, Lord." And Jesus looked at Peter and He said, "Before the cock crows, you will have denied me three times." And evidently, according to John's gospel, as they're walking down the Kidron Valley, making their way over to the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus wanted to encourage His followers with two basic things. He tells them of a coming city. Always hard to leave someone that you love. They've been following Him now for 3.5 years. So He says to them in John chapter 14, verses 1 through 3, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be forevermore." The next two chapters, He tells them of a coming comforter, a coming city, and until then, a coming comforter. He's told them, "It's to your advantage that I go away, because if I go not away, this comforter cannot come. But when He comes, you'll know it. He'll be in this world to reprove it of sin, righteousness, and of coming judgment." Oh, you'll know it. But He's going to be in you. A special place in the life of believers to encourage you when we're going through tough times as we currently are here in the world, actually. Well, Jesus was eating with His disciples. When He finished eating with His disciples, He made His way over to the Garden of Gethsemane. He asked His three closest followers if they would join Him in that garden for prayer. He showed them a certain spot where they were to remain while He was going to go deeper into that garden. And as He's there in that garden, He begins to sweat great drops of blood. He understands that His hour has come for the purpose for which He came into this world. And He cried out and He said, "Father, if it's possible, this cup could pass from me. That is, if there's any other way that a seed could bear fruit other than taking it out of the bottle and putting it into the ground to die. But if it's not possible, there's no other way for redemption to be accomplished. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. He came back three times and found his disciples sleeping. He came back the final time and he woke them up and he said, the hour has come. And sure enough, here came Judas leading that small band of men. And Jesus looked at that crowd that was coming to arrest him in the garden and he asked one question, whom do you seek? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus said to them, I am he. And the Bible says in John's gospel that they all fell backward. That should have got their attention. Should have known who they were dealing with. But they got up and they came again. Jesus asked the question over again, whom seek ye? Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said, I am he. Just before they arrested him, Simon Peter reached over and took out his sword. I personally am convinced that he was going for the neck of the servant of the high priest. His name is Malchus, and John gives us his name. And that servant ducked, and Peter chopped his ear off. And one of the last recorded miracles that we have in the Gospels is that Jesus stooped down and picked up that ear and put it back on Malchus's head. Hard to witness of somebody when you just cut their ear off, isn't it? Jesus was so loving, so compassionate, right up to the very end. So they bound my Savior, and they led him out of the garden. And the Bible says, according to John's gospel, that they led him to Caiaphas and Annas' palace. Annas was the father-in-law of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas. They started with him. And one of the questions that Annas had for Jesus was twofold. Tell us about your disciples. We want to know how big your army is. And the second question was, tell us about your doctrine. Jesus answered that question in the most unusual way. He said, look, I've been with you now for 3 years. I've actually taught in your temple. I've taught in your synagogues. You want to know what I believe? Go ask the people who heard me speak. And one of the servants of the high priest didn't like that answer. He hauled off and slapped Jesus Christ. The Bible says they went on to blindfold Jesus Christ. They struck him on the side of the head. And they asked him, prophesy. You're a prophet? Who was it that just hit you? Tell us, they said. They abused my Savior relentlessly. And then they took my Savior over to Caiaphas's palace and they continued their persecution. They vilified him. They spoke falsehood and lies about him. They brought in all kinds of false witnesses, but they couldn't get their testimonies to agree. They were so filled with hatred toward my Savior, they abused him unmercifully. In that setting, Peter was downstairs in the courtyard. A little maid comes up and says, you were with Jesus, weren't you? He denied it. A little while later, another maid comes along and says, wait a minute, your speech betrays you. You're one of them. Peter reacts. I don't know what you're talking about. And John's gospel says something very interesting. That a relative of Malchus who had his ear chopped off came up to Peter and says, no, you're one of them. You were in that garden. And that's where Peter began to curse and to swear and to say, I do not know the man. And then the cock crew, just like Jesus said it would. And the Bible goes out of its way to tell us that Peter looked up And at that time, Jesus looked down and their eyes met. And Peter went out and he wept bitterly. Well, early in the morning, they took Jesus to the other side of town, to the judgment hall where Pilate was in town. Pilate gets up and comes out and he says, what are you doing here? And they said, we brought this man to you who's a blasphemer. He's a liar. He's misleading the people. He claims to be the Son of God. And Pilate asked him a simple question, are you? You say that I am, Jesus replied. To this end was I born. And for this cause came I into the world. Pilate examined Jesus on three different occasions, and every time he examined him, he came up with the same conclusion. I find no fault in him at all. What do you do when you put a person on the witness stand and you examine them carefully and you come to the conclusion that they're innocent? Well, the natural thing to do is to let them go. But the Jewish leaders in front of Jesus that day began to curl up their fist and shake it at Pilate and say, if you let this man go, we'll tell your superior. We'll tell Caesar. And Pilate was checked, but he would never be checkmated. So he thought to himself very quickly, I know what I'll do. I'll send him across town and I'll let Herod look at him. He spent a little bit of time with Herod, but Herod quickly sent him back to Pilate. Pilate once again was in a checkmated position, but he would not be checkmated. And so he says, I know what I'll do. You Jewish people, you have a custom every year at this time of the year that we release unto you one of the prisoners. I'm going to bring out two prisoners. One is a notorious criminal. His name is Barabbas. The other is the innocent Son of God in whom I find no fault. You tell me, which would you prefer that I release unto you? And they began to clamor and they shouted and they said, give us Barabbas and crucify the Son of God. Pilate knew he was in trouble. The Bible says in the Gospel of John that he had Jesus scourged. They took my Savior back and they tied him to a whipping post. They used a cat of nine tails, leather straps, and at the end of those straps were sharp pieces of metal or broken glass. Many a prisoner has died at the hands of those men who did that. They brought that strap down across the back of my Savior. He was bruised and bleeding and bloody. And then they brought Jesus out for the crowds to see. They had put a crown of thorn on him. He thinks he's the king. Let's put a crown of thorns on him, they said. They took reeds and they began to beat the head of my Savior with those crowns of thorns. They put a robe on his back, put a scepter in his hand. They mocked him. Pilate brought him out to the Jewish people. And Pilate said, behold the man. I've examined him now three times. I find no fault in him. He went and got a bowl of water, dipped his hands in the water, and washed his hands and said, I'm innocent of the blood of this just man. And then Pilate passed the sentence on Jesus for him to be executed, Roman style. There is no worse form of punishment in this world known to man than a Roman execution rack called the cross. And so Jesus, with that crown of thorns, that beam upon his back, began to carry that cross down the Via Dolorosa. And halfway through carrying that cross out to Gordon's Calvary on the north side of town, he stumbled beneath the weight. There was a man in that crowd named Simon from Cyrene. And the Roman soldiers compelled him to carry the cross of Jesus the rest of the way. So they carried that cross up to Calvary. And they laid my Savior down on that cross. And they put spikes through his hands. They folded his feet and they put spikes through his feet. And Jesus hung on that cross beginning at 9 o'clock in the morning. And the first words out of my Savior's mouth, hanging in that desperate condition, was, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." One of the men hanging next to Jesus, a robber, a thief, noticed the way Jesus was responding to the situation that he was placed in. No one by nature can do this sort of a thing. He must be supernatural. So he looked at Jesus on the cross and he says, "I'd like to be forgiven. What do I need to do to come into your kingdom?" And Jesus saw his belief and he said, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." John's gospel actually records the next saying from the cross. Jesus, in that awful condition, looked down in that crowd and he saw someone that brought him great refreshment. It was his own mother with two other ladies standing next to her, and John standing next to his mother as well. And Jesus looked at John and he said, "Son, behold your mother, and mother, behold your son. John, take good care of my mother." And John did. And then the Bible says that at high noon, there was a tremendous shaking of the earth. At high noon, someone pulled the cord on the sun. It went completely black. At high noon, Jesus became sin for us who knew no sin, so that we might be made the righteousness of God, which is in Christ Jesus. And he cried out in that condition, my God, why have you abandoned me?" And then John records the next saying of Jesus from that cross, the fifth one. Jesus said, "I thirst." Please understand that Jesus was experiencing your hell, my hell, your punishment, my punishment on that cross. Isaiah 53 says he was led like a lamb to the slaughter, that he would be wounded for our iniquities, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace would be placed upon him, and with his stripes we would be healed. He was experiencing hell at that moment. Hell is a place of total darkness. It's a place of total thirst. It's a place where if you don't want God now, you won't have God then. He cried out, my God, why have you abandoned me?" We know why. Because at that moment, he became sin for the world. John also records the next saying from that cross, "It is finished." Telestai. The work has been complete. And then the Bible says Jesus bowed his head and said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." He bowed his head and he gave up the ghost. I'll tell you, you can learn a lot by standing at that cross and watching the way Jesus died. But you see, the sun is about to go down. The Jewish Passover is nigh. This was Friday. That fateful Friday. That fearful Friday. But Jesus knew that Sunday was coming. You need to know that if you're in a hopeless situation today, that there's a glorious resurrection Sunday that's coming, that's just around the corner. There were two men that day. Their names are Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. What's interesting to me that Joseph of Arimathea is mentioned in each of the gospel accounts. Matthew tells us he was rich. Mark's account tells us he was a member of the Sanhedrin. Luke said he was a good man and a just man. If you've got your Bible, in John's gospel, it says he was a disciple of Jesus Christ, but he did it secretly. And there was something about watching the way Jesus die on that cross that compelled both Joseph of Arimathea as well as Nicodemus to come out of the closet and be bold for Jesus Christ. Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate, and he begged the body of Jesus. And they took the body down, they wrapped it in linen garments, and they poured spices in as they did it. And Joseph was so rich, he had a tomb in that garden next to where Jesus died, and they lay the body of Jesus there. And then they waited. And the next thing to happen is where we get our hope. When you read John chapter 20, verse 1, the Bible says that early in the morning, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb, and that stone was already rolled back. Wasn't rolled back so that Jesus could get out. He was now in his glorified body. It was rolled back so that people could have a look in. And she was so touched by what she saw that she ran to Peter and John, wanting to tell what she had just seen. John's gospel tells how these two men ran to the tomb to make sure it was so. He even tells us that John outran the other, Peter. And John knelt down outside the tomb, but Peter ran right in. In verse 8, it says that Peter, inside the tomb, John comes in to see it, and the Bible says that John saw and believed. In the jury box, he raises his hand and says, "I'm totally convinced." Are you convinced that Jesus rose from the grave? Are you convinced he's the Son of God who came to die on that cross for you, shed his life's blood, and rise again so that you could have eternal life, to write your name in the Lamb's book of life forever? Mary must have come back to that tomb. And out of the corner of her eye, she sees what she perceived to be the gardener. And she's weeping. And the gardener, in her mind, asks her, "Why are you weeping?" And she says, "They've taken my Lord away. And now we don't know where they've laid him." But the moment Jesus called her name, it came flooding back to her what Jesus had done for her, how he drove out all those demons and how he gave her eternal life, how he changed her life and transformed her life as a follower of Jesus Christ. And she wanted to hug him and embrace him. Talk about social distancing. Jesus said, "Don't touch me, Mary. I've not yet ascended back to my Father in heaven." But what we see in John's gospel ought to cause every one of us to stop and realize that Jesus Christ really is who he claims to be. First part of the gospel, he affirms it. Second part of the gospel, he accomplished what he came into this world to do. And if you don't see that, it's not because you can't see it. It's because you choose not to see it. The evidence is right there in front of you. I'm going to close with this. It means the world to me. It's a true story. There was a farmer one day in Africa. He had an old skinny mule, and he had an old metal plow, and he had a great big farm. The neighbors felt sorry for him. He'd go up one row, turn that plow around, and go back down the other row. And along the way, he'd have to stop and move stones and rocks out of the way, take them over to the fence row, made a great big pile. One day he was doing that, a neighbor came by and said, you know, "I don't know why you're working so hard. Have you not heard that people are discovering diamonds all around the world? And if you just discover a diamond or two, you won't have to labor like this anymore." That farmer went to sleep on those words, became highly discontented with his work. Got up the next morning. He asked his wife and his two children to go stay with their parents. While he put a for sale sign up and sold the farm, he literally went to Palestine, Europe. He ended up in Spain searching for diamonds and was so frustrated and so depressed that it never materialized. As a matter of fact, different accounts of this, but one of the accounts says there was a tidal wave coming toward Barcelona one day. And in a fit of depression, this man, instead of running from the tidal wave, he went out to the dock and he dove into the tidal wave and committed suicide. Meanwhile, back on the farm, the next farmer purchased it. He was plowing with a mule, moving rocks out of the way. And he came across a rock one day that had an unusual color. So impressed, enamored with that rock, that he took and put it above his fireplace on the mantle. And a man came from town wanting to welcome him to the community. Saw that unusual color rock over the fireplace and said, "What is that?" The farmer said, "Well, that's just a rock I got out of the field. I thought it was kind of unusual." And the man visiting said, "That's no ordinary rock. That's a diamond. And one of the largest diamond fields ever to be discovered was where this farmer, who sold his property, searched all the world over to find diamonds. It's where he started." I'm saying to you this morning that you may be searching the world over for happiness, peace, fulfillment. And you might want to look in front of you. You might want to consider the claims of the Lord Jesus Christ, who he really is, and the purpose for why he came into this world. When I look over at that jury box and I see 12 disciples, with the exception of Judas, every one of those men were so convinced that Jesus is the Christ, they were willing to lay down their lives for it. And the question you have to answer right now is, what will you do with Jesus? Will you repent of your sin? Ask him to come in and sit as Lord on your heart's throne and be your Lord and personal Savior. If you'll do that, he'll come in. And he'll do for you what he's done for countless other people. If you're spiritually blind, he'll give you sight. You're spiritually paralyzed, he'll raise you up and give you eternal life so you can follow him. If you're dead in trespasses and in sin, as was Lazarus, he can just speak the word and give you eternal life right now, right there where you're sitting. Father, thank you for the truth of John's gospel. In these very hopeless days, I thank you that you took us from that hopeless Friday, that eerie Friday, that Friday of confusion and uncertainty. And I'm thankful that the gospel does not stop with Friday, but that you get us over to Sunday morning, when the people that came by that tomb saw that the stone was rolled away. And just as Romans chapter 4, verse 25 declares, Jesus, my Savior, was indeed crucified on that cross. He died so that our sin could be forgiven. But he rose again so that we could be declared righteous in the sight of a holy God. Thank you for that wonderful truth. I pray for that individual right now who's on the verge of making a decision for Jesus Christ, that you would encourage them to surrender their heart, their life, completely to you and say, Lord, here I am. I want to become a follower of Jesus Christ. We ask this and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. My light, my strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, burn through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled with striving seas. death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he
in prayer this morning. Mike had mentioned earlier about our offerings coming in, and we thought as part of that we would also pray for those offerings that come in. Father, we are so thankful for the opportunity to come together and to worship you. Lord, we think of the conditions that are around and about us. Help us and calm our panics, Lord, and just help us to do wise things. Father, as we learned this morning, you want our time and our talents and our treasures. And Father, as we think of our treasures, they're all yours to begin with. As we do continue to give back a portion of that which you've given us, Lord, help us to remember it is yours and help us to do it with a cheerful heart. Father, also we pray that you would take those tithes and offerings and bless them and break them. But Father, because of what you did for us on the cross, more than our treasures, you want our time and our talents and our worship. And Father, help us to do that throughout this week. Father, we do thank you for giving of your Son to shed his precious blood for our sin, that we might repent of that sin and ask him to be our personal Lord and Savior and to live for him. Lord, we pray that again, as we go through this time apart, that you would draw us closer to you. And Father, we do look forward to the time again when we can worship corporately. Father, we do ask that you would help us throughout this week to focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.